This is Current Yield, Grant's Interest Rate Observer of the Air. And the fellow with a cracked voice is me. I'm Jim Grant. And with me, as always, is the great deputy editor of Grant's, Evan Lorenz. Welcome, Evan. And Henry French is at the control panel, as per usual. And with us today is Dan Rasmussen. He was kind of the master of many things. You know, I knew a guy named Lou Lehrman. This is indirect introduction to the most formidable resume of Dan. And Lou Lehrman came of age for the draft. This is the early 1960s, I guess. They said such a thing as conscription. Selective service. You kind of had to serve in the military or present evidence why you're unfit. So Lou Lehrman goes to see his local army recruiter, and the sergeant asks him, so, kid, tell me about yourself. Well, Lou says, I graduated from Yale after going to the Hill School. I went to Hill School, then Yale. I was a distinguished scholar. And then I went to Harvard and received my graduate. And the sergeant says, look, kid, I haven't got time for this. Either you're a liar or you ought to be a general. In any case, you're out of here. And so Dan Rasmussen, I'll get around to Dan in a second, but his resume reminds me a little bit of Lou Lehrman's in 1962. But, Evan, as I was going to say before I interrupted myself, I want to comment on the narrative, as we say now, the narrative surrounding the debt ceiling talks and the talk about the unprecedented nature of the prospective default on the federal debt. And I'm going to say that it would not be the first. It would not be unique. It would be the third. The first occurred in 1933, as the British newspapers said, London papers said, it's the American default, by which the price of gold into which the dollar was then converted went from $20.67 to $35 without consulting any single American creditor. That's one. And the second was in 1971, when U.S. Declined to exchange any pieces of paper for gold at the statutory rate. So those are two defaults, and this would be a third. So I want to say that the United States is well practiced in the art of default.
Well, at least we have a game plan.
Yeah. So Dan Rasmussen, Dan, welcome. And okay, so I should explain your resume. It's first Harvard, then Stanford, but no Yale. Am I correct, Dan?
No Yale.
Okay. And Dan is the founder, is it correct, Dan? Founder?
Yes.
Okay. And would you tell our listeners, please, about your firm and what you do for a living before we begin the interrogation?
Yes, absolutely. I started and run an asset management firm called Verdad, and we manage a variety of different strategies. We manage small cap value strategies, the specialty in Japan. We manage some credit strategies, and we also manage an opportunistic strategy that we invest in times of crisis, which we did last during COVID. And we haven't had a chance to do that again since COVID, but perhaps around the corner, we'll have another shot at it.
Yeah. As I read some of your recent material, you have now or soon will have on your staff actually an economist from Yale, no, who is an authority on crises before they happen.
Yes, it's Sam Hansen. He's at Harvard.
Oh, Harvard. Same thing, right?
but yes, he's done work on what he calls predictable financial crises, and is somewhat of an expert on credit markets. So it was timely moment for him to join us.
Well, what does he think? Is this if it's foreseeable? Does he foresee one?
You know, he's an academic, so he's cagey about such things. But if you use the methodology from his paper, which looks at credit growth and asset growth as predictors of financial crisis, the U.S. right now is in what his paper would call sort of the red zone, where we've had, you know, way too rapid expansion of credit and assets, and that usually portends some sort of reckoning to come.
Yeah,
I think the paper said the 3 year after the peak is when the crisis is most likely to happen. And I think his paper said it, that peak was at the end of 2020. Wouldn't that put
right.
the crisis kind of, you know, on calendar for this year?
It would, yes. Although I still think it's not 100% probability. I think even when you're in the red zone, it's maybe a 50% probability or something like that. So it's by no means a certainty, but certainly the chances of it happening are significantly higher given the backdrop we've had.
Yeah, Dan, I think you first came into my line of sight, and I dare say it was a belated sighting because you had done so many things before this. But I remember so well, and we wrote about it as if it were yesterday. a paper you did on private equity, and this was 2018, and it was the most persuasive piece of analysis I'd ever read on the vulnerabilities and the pretensions of private equity. And I think the headline had something to do with overhyped and overleveraged, certainly overleveraged, and I dare say overhyped then and perhaps at intervals following. But the gist of this, again, as I recall it, was that private equity is kind of small cap or micro cap with a lot of leverage, and that claims by the promoters to improve the operational efficiency of the businesses they subsume and leverage, that claim is largely bogus. And could you, if that summary is inadequate, please elaborate. And if you would, please bring us up to date on private equity. What's happened to it? And is it part of the prospective 50-50 of financial difficulty we may have in 2023 or a year to be named later?
Yeah. So private equity, you know, two defining characteristics of the asset class are size and leverage. So private equity is micro cap exposure. The median market cap of a private equity deal is about 180 million or so. And remember, the large end of the micro cap index is 400 million, right? So these are really, really small companies. And private equity is also distinguished by its use of leverage. Generally, they are levering companies about 60 to 65% on a net debt to enterprise value basis. And those things have been true since the 80s. Private equity is always focused on smaller companies, companies too small for the private markets, for the public markets, I mean, that are traded privately. And they've always used debt, right? Originally, it was the leverage buyout industry. And maybe in the 80s, you could get 90% leverage, but that's come down over time. And what I sort of noted when I started my career in sort of around 2010, was this shift where call it 05, 06, you know, private equity went from being a really off the beaten path strategy that had been adopted by some leading endowments to a pretty widespread strategy where everybody was plugging it into their asset allocation models. So huge amounts of money were raised in 05 and 06 and 07. And then after the financial crisis, I'd say the last decade has been the decade of the rise of private equity. To the point where, you know, large institutional consultants tell their clients they should have 40% of their money in private equity, which is a truly, you know, astronomical share, given that this is microcap exposure. So 40% of your portfolio in microcaps, right? To me, that seems a little bit excessive, but that's the current in vogue thinking among smart asset allocators. And along with that very sharp increase in funds was a big shift in valuation. So it used to be true that in private markets, you'd pay a 40% discount or so to public markets, which makes sense, right? You're buying smaller, riskier companies. You're buying them sort of off the market, as it were, and you were getting them at a cheaper price. And you could exit them by selling them to big public companies. But since the asset class really, you know, became institutionalized, first prices converged. So by 05, 06, 07, you know, PE was paying the same price as, say, the S&P 500, even though the companies were a lot smaller and a lot riskier. They were trading for the same multiples. The arbitrage had been closed. And what you've seen over the last decade is a further shift to where private equity reliably pays higher prices than the S&P 500. And along with paying higher prices than the S&P 500, you know, maybe 10, even 20% higher prices, because the prices are high, or maybe, you know, it's a chicken and egg situation, but the private equity firms themselves have therefore shifted into what they perceive as above GDP growth industries that they think will grow faster than, say, the S&P 500 constituents. And that means that tech and healthcare technology, which used to be about 10% of private equity, you know, pre-2010, is now upwards of 50%. And so what you've seen is the private equity's shift from small cap value into small cap growth, from, you know, traditional industries, industrials and consumer discretionary, and into a big, big bet on technology. And so what you're seeing now is, you know, private equity firms in 2021 and 2020 paying, you know, 18, 19, 20 times GAAP EBITDA, and putting, you know, 8, 9, 10 turns of debt, net debt to EBITDA of debt on the balance sheet. And by the way, most of that debt, which is coming from these newfangled private credit providers, which is its own, you know, dark story, is mostly floating rate debt. And so I think you're at a situation now where multiples in public markets and in private equity have probably come down 20%. And the cost of debt, that floating rate debt, has obviously gone, you know, way up. You know, maybe if they were borrowing it, you know, I don't know what they would have been borrowing at right before the crisis, but
nothing.
In 2021, maybe call it 600, 700 basis points over treasuries, right? And now when treasuries were, you know, close to zero, and now they're close to 500 basis points, right? So this is a big material increase in debt costs for their portfolio companies. And so I think, you know, private equity is in a tough spot, right? There's this sort of vise where multiples, exit multiples have come down, right? They pretty clearly can't sell companies for the same prices they paid for them in 18, 19, 20, 21. And the blooms come off the rose a little bit for these technology companies that they overloaded on. And second, the cost of debt has gone materially up at the same time. And I think that puts them in a pretty tricky situation. Now, I've been probably calling the private equity bubble since 2018, and it hasn't blown up yet. So maybe you can dismiss me as the boy who cried wolf. And I think there's certainly truth to the fact that I thought private equity was in a bubble in 2018. And what ended up happening is that tech, which is the large exposure, you know, that they were betting 50% of their portfolios on technology and healthcare technology, you know, ended up having this sort of blow off the top moment in 2020 and 2021, where, you know, if you thought you paid a crazy price any time before that, you know, you were still in the money because the prices just went crazier. But now things are starting to come down to earth and there's starting to be reckoning. And I think, you know, the reckoning is going to be felt the worst by those who bought at crazy prices and bought at crazy prices with floating rate debt.
Dan, in addition to your many other accolades, you sit on an investment committee for an endowment. When you wrote that 2018 article, you marveled at the fact that private equity was then paying 11 times EBITDA for buyouts on average, up from 8.9 times in 2007, which was the prior peak. Before our conversation, Jim and I printed out a McKinsey report that says private equity paid 12.9 times EBITDA for buyouts last year and a peak of 13.2 times in 2021. So my question for you is, what were allocators thinking when they were giving out money to private equity funds to buy at these all-time records? And what are they thinking now that valuations have at least fallen in public markets, if not, you know, the marks that private equity puts on their own portfolio companies?
Yeah, and one important thing to note about all those numbers, those EBITDA multiples that you mentioned, is that those numbers, the way they're built, is off what the private equity firms report. It's not off GAAP numbers. And so those are really pro forma EBITDA numbers. And KPMG did a study called 2 years back on the difference between pro forma and GAAP. And they generally found that, you know, GAAP EBITDA is about a third lower than pro forma EBITDA. So if you multiply, you know, each of those numbers by 1.3 or so, you're getting probably close to the GAAP numbers that would be comparable with public markets. Just like the marks of private equity are somewhat BS, the reported valuations are also a BS because of this pro forma accounting thing.
Well, in any case, the valuations are very high. But what did allocators think when they were putting money to work at these all-time high valuations, however high they were? And are they ruining this now? I mean, I know that private equity works on a commitment basis. So you commit maybe $1 billion, but the private equity funds call that over time. So now these allocators are getting calls after they've already, you know, committed money at very high multiples to companies that maybe aren't doing so great now. So what was the thought process, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, and how are people approaching it today?
Yeah. So I think that from an allocator's perspective, you know, private equity is the perfect investment, right? It has two characteristics. One characteristic is that at least historically, you know, with maybe a few exceptions, you know, almost every vintage year of private equity has beaten the public equity markets. And so if you're an allocator, you're saying, hey, I can get equity equal or greater to equity returns. And by the way, the reported volatility on these plus S&P 500 plus returns is comparable to investment grade bonds. So, you know, probably the reported vol on PE is 10%, the S&P is 16%, and small caps are 23 or 24, right? So, you know, that you're basically looking at an asset class that delivers, you know, an unbelievable Sharpe ratio and allows the investor to have a feeling of quote unquote phony happiness, right? That nothing bad ever happens in private equity. The S&P is down 20, you know, private equity will be down 10. Why? Because they mark their own books. And so, you know, I think when you look at it from my lens and you're saying, hey, look at these valuations, look at these leverage levels, you know, look at, you know, borrowing 7 or 8 times net debt to EBITDA is insane. You know, that feels like triple C rated credit to me, and it's floating rate. And what if interest rates rise? Or, you know, these valuations are insane and the industry concentration is insane. You know, who would put their portfolio, you know, 50% into technology? And, you know, I think that's one perspective. And the other perspective is, every one of my peers is taking their exposure from 30 to 35% to this asset class that said magically good returns and magically low risk. And I'd be crazy not to do more of it. And so I think there's a huge gap between those that look at this in from my analytical lens and the vast majority of practitioners for whom this is the best thing since sliced bread.
I recall us having a discussion a couple of years ago, and I think you confessed that you were a little bit of an enfant terrible at Stanford University, that you were not the guy the professor delighted to see walk into his classroom because there'd be a lot of tough questions from the back of the room. Now, is that fairly recollected?
It is.
Okay. So given that, it's not surprising to me or to Evan, I think, that Verdad seems to be in the opposition wing in finance. Now, there is a mainline, momentum-driven, narrative-friendly, and hype-embracing wing that makes the money. And those of us in the principled opposition don't mind not making so much of it because we at least can look at ourselves in the mirror while we shave. Isn't that right, Evan?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So is that a fair characterization a little bit of the mindset of Verdad? Are you people actually as contrary-minded, as bloody-minded, and as indefatigable in your analysis as it would seem from this podcast so far?
That's nice of you to say, Joe. I think there are two sides to that. I think obviously we're very there's one thing I take on faith, which is the resurrection of our Lord, and everything else I want to see the data, and I think that we have a very principled approach to analyzing that data, which often leads us to tangential conclusions. But as you put it, the last few years in the U.S. equity market have made me wish I was a fad enthusiast, because being a disciplined value investor or noting things like, wow, Japan looks really, really cheap, has led you to dramatically underperform things like the AI or ARK Invest, much less the NASDAQ. So it's a funny thing to be in the opposition.
Do we do about this?
I think the reckoning is coming. I mean, I think that you can't look at from a historical perspective, look at, you know, where valuations are today or relative valuations and not come to the conclusion that the closest analog to where we are today is 1999 or 2000, which is, probably my view to some extent of where we are.
Speaking of analogs, and I'm not sure if you had this in mind when you wrote the somewhat spicy headline over a piece about low profitability and high hype stocks being on a tear. But the headline, ladies and gentlemen, was Revenge of the Turds. Yeah, that's T as in tango. And it's a piece about garbage stocks. Now, do you know, Dan, what era the phrase garbage stock was coined?
I don't.
It was 1960, late 60s. We call it the Great Garbage Market. And in preparation for this performance today, I actually went on my phone and typed in Great Garbage Market. This was an Adam Smith, maybe, who wrote, the author wrote in the pseudonym Adam Smith. He wrote The Money Game and like that. And it was a Great Garbage Market of 1968, perhaps. And you know what came up? It's the great garbage ocean. Is that about plastics in the Pacific? Oh, that's got nothing to do with it. Hey, phone. this windy preface to a question is all about the nature, the recurrent cyclicality. I guess I'm being redundant, but the cyclicality of markets. Nothing is ever exactly pristinely new, no?
Yes, history repeats itself. And, I think like you, Jim, although in a much less distinguished way, I see myself as a historian of the market, or that's what interests me, because I think that in order to get to truth, and or at least what you might think of as truth in the market, you have to look across multiple cycles and look across history and find analogs and think about base rates and say, how have similar things worked in the past? That's what makes me so skeptical of these, low profitability, high investment, hype driven things. I mean, I, you know, whether it's, food delivery on demand or, electric trucks or, whatever it might be. Aviation, vertical takeoff and landing aviation, flying taxis or whatever the heck they are, that stuff I'm just inherently skeptical of, because the history of stocks that look like popular science covers has been, a disaster. Except for the last few years.
Yeah, except for your investment career.
So Dan, in terms of garbage stocks, we have a lot of analogs for what happens when kind of trashy companies without really good financials and good earnings power, like, get overvalued. They fall. They sometimes crash. In the 1970s was a market which kind of trended sideways for a decade, despite inflation being very high. After the dot-com peak, we had the dot-com crash. We have not, at least I don't know of a good analog for a crash in private equity. Right now, McKinsey says...
What was the phrase, Dan? Leveraged buyouts. Yeah. Yep. Look at 1989, 90, 91. That was an analog.
Nabisco. How do you think this private equity bubble plays out? Is it like the 1980s where certain firms like KKR are kind of kicked out of fundraising for, 7 or 8 years as they kind of, digest their problems? Is it like hedge funds where after peaking, before the Great Recession, they just kind of treaded sideways for a decade? Or is this something like is going to cause a sudden crash? Because as you pointed out, the typical buyouts leverage, 6 to 9 times EBITDA. A large proportion of that funding is through variable rate debt. And, the reference rate SOFR has increased by 500 basis points over the last year. Is this a drawn out thing? Is it a boom? Is it how do you?
It's hard to answer. And I think, because private equity now is largely funded by private credit on the debt side. So, you have, KKR doing a deal that's funded by debt from Ares or something, right? So you have these private lenders and the source of their capital, by the way, is the endowed institutions and pension funds who fall for what I call fool's yield. And they, what's interesting about private credit is that they advertise very, very low default rates. And Cambridge Associates did a great study where they said, well, wait a second, your default rates are very low, but your amendment rates are very high. So yes, you didn't force them into default. You said, gee, you don't have to pay. We're just going to amend the terms of the loan, so you don't have to pay for a few quarters or whatever it might be, right? And that kind of is a default. So if you define amendments as defaults, then actually the default rate of private credit looks a lot like single B or even triple C credit, which would make sense given the in yields and interest rates. So I think what you have to see then is that there's an incentive for both the private equity fund and the private credit fund to kick the can down the road and to hope for better days. And so, it's hard to predict a scenario in which there's sort of a dramatic blow up, because none of this is priced by a market and or subject to a run, because how do you get your money out of a private equity fund or a private credit fund? You can't. I think the more likely scenario is this long, letting out of the air, out of the tires, as returns kind of flatline or go negative for a few years. And I think the interesting thing is, I just think there's such a mismatch between what asset allocators think they're getting and expect to get from a return perspective and what the basic fundamentals of the transactions they're executing on would imply would hold for the future.
Yeah, Dan, I can't help but think that you're a yes but guy in a gee whiz world, and I want you to know that that's no crime in this office, right, Evan?
No.
Yeah. Okay. Hey, but let's stop flogging private equity, which seems not to know when it's licked. It ought to have known that in 2018 with the publishing of a very fine essay. But let's talk about things that do look enticing. A couple of, I guess maybe 2 weeks ago, we talked to an associate of yours, Dan, who had just done a very interesting analysis of the opportunities in Europe, and it was all paradox and the unexpected. A Europe, a sleepy Europe, outdoor museum of Europe is generating better margins than tech and better returns.
I believe it had like a better, slower earnings drawn down last year than the Nasdaq. A better margin retention lasted than NASDAQ.
And so tell it. Let's start with Europe. Could you reprise some of what I have been trying to describe and tell us where the opportunity lies and what the risks might be?
Exactly. I mean, so you had this phenomenon last year where because of the war in Ukraine and the energy issues associated with Russia, almost everybody, you know, myself, I confess included, thought that Europe was headed into an inevitable and deep recession. It turned out that the energy crisis was manageable. And it turned out that European companies were a lot more resilient than you would have thought. And you fast forward to today, you know, European stocks have beaten the NASDAQ, I think, over the past, you know, 6 to 12 months. The profits certainly have held up better. Margins have been better in terms of the change year over year. And so you're looking at a situation where actually, if you said to me a year ago, you know, who would do better, you know, European companies or the NASDAQ, you would have said, you got to be crazy. You know, Europe is just on a certain doom. But what's actually happened is that you've had a normalization of the crazy tech earnings. And so you've seen a pretty big decline for a lot of those companies in terms of their revenues and profits and margins. And Europe has held up quite well and even grown in some cases as companies recovered from, you know, I think the scare of last year.
But these are mainly cyclical companies, are they not? The ones that have done so well?
Yes, yes, yes. And that's a familiar story, right? I mean, value investing is about expectation errors. And so when you see a big error of a difference between reality and expectation, that's when value investors make money. And the expectation for Europe were so bad, and the reality has been okay to good. And that's driven a massive rally in the share prices. And you look today, and Europe is still remarkably cheap. I mean, I think that there's just this been this broad dynamic over the last 10 years, which every asset allocator is aware of, where international money is, international equities have just been dead money relative to the U.S., and it's just been disappointment after disappointment. And I think everyone, people have adapted to that, and they just kind of come up with rationalizations, right? The U.S. is more innovative, it's better run, more shareholder friendly, et cetera, and therefore, you know, why would you invest, in Europe, which is, you know, sleepy and dull and, it's a museum
baseball. Japan's got baseball, no baseball in Europe.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe it's marginally better. And that's created this opportunity where these firms are, you know, undercapitalized, and they just haven't had the same flows, and they're valued much cheaper. And you're getting, you know, largely the same type of company with the same type of growth prospects for a lot lower price. And I think that's what's really driven a lot of the recovery this year in European equities.
Could you give us a couple of four instances about companies that strike you as maybe epitomizing the opportunity in Europe? We talked to Brian Cingono about this. And I can't remember exactly the companies he mentioned. If you can't, I'm not going to hold that against you because I can't.
Yeah, I mean, I think one example on the spicier, riskier end, and I know I'm always attracted to those types of names, so that's why it's at the top of my mind, is Ericsson, which makes all the 5G technology. They, Nokia, and Huawei make all the 5G technology that Verizon's and AT and British Telecoms and all those use. That's a company which, to me, you know, 5G demand seems to be going up, if not stable, and they're the leading producer of it. But the stock trades at, you know, 5x EBITDA or something like that, in part because it's in Europe and in part because they've had a series of scandals. But that's a prime example. But there are so many others. I mean, on the auto side, you have, you know, Stellantis, which is just insanely cheap, but a lot of automakers are cheap. They're
not, you know, all of them, right, Evan?
Not all of them. I can think of at least one that has a pretty high multiple.
Yes, exactly. So, you know, if you're willing to go for one that isn't magic and run by a wizard, then Stellantis is for you.
Dan, tell us about Japan.
Yes. So Japan, you know, is probably my favorite one of my favorite topics and favorite places to invest. And as a firm, we're massively overweight Japan and have been for years. Japan's a fascinating phenomenon. So I think, you know, there are a few big things to know about Japan and sort of where they are in the macro economy right now, in the macroeconomic cycle. You know, the first big thing to know is that they were hit by two really bad things. The first was the China trade wars that started really in 2018. And then second was COVID. And Japan had, if you thought, you know, Australia or, you know, Michigan was bad, you know, Japan was crazy in terms of their COVID reaction. So they didn't actually reopen their borders to foreign travel until November of 2022. So the island was effectively sealed off from March of 20 to November of 2022. And tourism and travel, you know, accounted for about 8% of GDP. in Japan. And so you had this just massive self-inflicted, in my view, wound to the country based on bad COVID policies and on the China trade wars. And so you basically saw, you know, peak earnings for Japan were probably 2017 or 2018. And we're just getting back to the point where, you know, maybe 2023 numbers will be better than that. So you've had this sort of lost half decade from a profit perspective. And now you're starting to see this recovery where tourism is coming back, where travel is coming back, where, you know, trade is recovering. And that, you know, big shift in economic prospects in a normally slow growth environment, coupled with, you know, Japan being just astonishingly cheap, you know, cheap relative to its own history, cheap relative to the U.S. by far. You know, it's just there's no metric possibly in which you can look at Japan and not say this is a bargain. Even dividend yields, which Japan is famous for having, you know, bad capital allocation and lower, you know, dividend payout ratios and things like that. And now even dividend yields are higher in Japan than the United States. And so you've got this, you know, crazily cheap country where the economic prospects look very different from a lot of places in the world, where you're in the midst of the reopening trade still, where inflation really isn't a problem, and where I think there are, you know, multiple positive catalysts that are occurring sort of simultaneously against a backdrop of extraordinarily cheap valuations.
And Japan has long been the place where there are cheap equities that stay cheap. But in the last decade, starting under Kuroda, but continuing even through this year, they've made major progress in trying to improve corporate governance. And even this January, the Tokyo Stock Exchange sent out a letter threatening companies trading under book value that you better do something to improve it, including increasing your dividend yield or increasing buybacks. And after the latest rash of earnings, we've actually seen a lot of companies like Hitachi, Fujitsu, and do very large buybacks or increase their dividends pretty substantially.
Yes. I mean, I thought that was one of that central bank governor statement. I mean, that was just one of the all-time greats, you know, getting mad at companies for having too low price to book multiples. I mean, it was just great. You know, if you have a price to book multiple below one, you know, you're in trouble. I mean, it was just a great moment. So classically Japanese. But it's real. I mean, it's just kind of absurd. And I think the, you know, other thing to be aware of in Japan is that it's very prestigious in Japan to be a public company. It's and so there's a huge number of public companies and they stay public forever. So, you know, in the US, you know, you look up companies and they've been listed for 5 years and renamed 7 years ago or whatever. And in Japan, you're buying, you know, Janome Sewing Company, which was founded in 1892. And, you know, maybe it doesn't do sewing machines anymore or whatever, but it's still public under the same name and has been, you know, public for 30 years. And was founded in 1890. And so you have just this very different dynamic in Japan where you just have this huge, huge long tail of small companies that are public. You know, they're probably the same number of listed tickers in Japan as there are in the United States. And so there's just a huge variety of different things to choose from and that are quite fun as a foreigner to learn about. One of my favorite examples is there are, we've been invested in this Japanese wedding companies. And you say, you know, what in heaven's name is a wedding company? But in Japan, they don't have, you know, American churches, but everyone has seen Hollywood movies with, you know, church weddings. And so there's a huge demand in Japan for church weddings. So these wedding companies have gone and built fake churches all around Japan where you can go and get married. And they have themed weddings. You know, you can get a monster hunter themed wedding in a fake American church in the middle of Tokyo. Gee, I mean, it's just kind of totally nuts.
So you're short this thing, are you?
No, we're long.
Oh, Jim. I see. Hey,
sometimes maybe my contrarianism takes me too far, I admit.
It sounds like 500 Las Vegas is a guy. Anyway, so tell me about the risk that the Bank of Japan's most radical protracted policies actually work and the inflation they have rooted for, low this generation, materializes and the not problematic 3% inflation turns into 4, 5, 6, could happen, has happened in some places we know. Meanwhile, their 10-year yield is pegged at 47 basis points, I think. And so interest rates in Japan go from 2, 3, 4, 5. And they're the equities that look cheap now, but they might be considerably cheaper if, as and when, the inflationary embers take real fire.
Yeah, I think that's certainly a risk. And I, you know, I think obviously it's salient because that's what happened in the US, where we copied Japanese policies and they had a rather bad consequence. But I think what probably reassures me is that, you know, on a sort of relative basis, Japan didn't have anywhere near the COVID spending blowout that the United States has. So, you know, the bad things that Japan has, you know, you and I would think were bad things the central bank has been doing, they've kind of been doing forever. And it's not like it's accelerated in any meaningful way or that they went crazy for the last 2 years. They were sort of steady Eddie on the same track.
They went crazy buying JGBs. My goodness, they spent what percent of GDP? A million percent or something? Anyway,
I think they own almost the entire stock of 10-year JGBs. Yeah. And in fact, I think they maybe own like more than 100% because they lend out the bonds to banks and then buy them back.
Okay. Well, this has been a great conversation with somebody who is just as bloody minded, I think, as you are, Evan. And it's surprising to meet someone like this. But Dan Rasmussen is a published author, entrepreneur, alumnus of only the best institutions, and a guest on Current Yield, Grant's Interest Rate Observer of the Air. So thank you for all those things, Dan, especially the latter.
My pleasure. Well, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, it was a delight. Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, we'll talk soon. This is Jim Grant on behalf of Grant's Interest Rate Observer.